I'm Charlie Taylor, and welcome to Skillsoft Off the Shelf. Today, I'm talking with Jennifer Kahnweiler, author of The Introverted Leader. Jennifer has been hailed as a champion of introverts. She helps introverted people expand their capacity for leadership and also promotes better understanding of the strength of introverts, including ways to make the workplace more inclusive. Jennifer, welcome to Skillsoft Off the Shelf.
I'm thrilled to be here. Thank you for inviting me.
The introverted leader seems like a paradox. It's hard to imagine that introverts can be naturally inclined to be leaders. So can you tell us what motivated you to write this book?
Well, actually, introverts are leaders. We'll talk more about that in our discussion today. But truly, what really motivated me was my personal relationship to begin with my new spouse, who I was very perplexed by. I couldn't understand why he didn't answer me when I barraged him with questions. I soon learned after that, after attending a workshop and the woman's describing an introvert and the qualities of an introvert, that they like to recharge their energy after being with people and are very quiet and calm, I realized that she was describing my husband. And at the same time, she described extroverts, and that was me. And I think many people have that experience when they have that awareness, and that's what happened to me in my personal life. So I took that into the workplace, where I was working as a consultant, a leadership coach, an HR professional, and I kept being very frustrated myself and had empathy for my clients because they were not getting the opportunities I thought they deserved and being passed over simply because they were more introverted and not kind of conforming to the type A sort of extroverted culture they were finding themselves in. So I collected data on that through the years, and it ended up my journey as I try to understand more about how introverts learn, how they inspire, how they lead. It ended up being a series of books that we're talking about today, the new edition actually of The Introverted Leader.
So you don't consider yourself an introvert?
No, I am not an introvert, as many of my friends will probably attest to. However, what I've learned from this journey of exploring how introverts lead and learn and inspire others is that I can tap into my introvert side, and so can everybody else. We can all move from one side to the other. In fact, the term ambivert has now taken the hold in the zeitgeist, if you will, where people realize that there are strengths on both sides of the equation. Being introverted and being more within ourselves, taking quiet time, really reflecting, has so many assets, as does being extroverted when we get out there and connect with people and build relationships. So there's advantages to both sides. It's just we have to be more aware, I believe, of what our natural preference is. And then we can build on that.
Are there any trends in the workplace that have contributed to this updated edition?
Yes. Mm-hmm. I took a lot of notes from the feedback that I got from readers and also speaking about this topic, and I was able to integrate some of those learnings. And one of the things that's very exciting that's happening now, I'm calling it the rise of the introverts, is that, you know, we're talking a lot about diversity within workplaces and within cultures and in the world, which I think is such a positive thing. And one of the aspects that has now starting to be talked about more, and which I respond reflected in the book, was that diversity also includes those hidden factors, the factors that you can't always see on the surface. You know, we can see race, we can see gender, but personality and style, oftentimes there are disconnects and misunderstandings about people based on their style and their personality. And so introverts have kind of been under the radar, but now we're talking about introversion in that context of diversity. And organizations are starting to realize how important it is to tap into between 40 and 60% of people and their contributions to the world. I mean, our organizations need that, particularly in a time now of such competition. We also, another trend that has been very predominant is the global nature of our work. And so in addition to culture, for instance, I work a lot with people from Asia, and many of us do, there's also the fabric of introversion, or that's underlying a lot of that. So knowing that, or putting that, you looking through that lens, in addition to, as I say, gender, culture, ethnicity, and so many other dimensions of diversity, is so powerful. And many people didn't realize that until now. So we're talking in the last 10 years or so where introversion has really come to the fore. You know, people used to say to me, how could you be an introvert and a leader? Or, you know, that's kind of like, look at you with deer in the headlights. But now it's becoming much more talked about and accepted.
Can you talk a little bit about introverts? Like, what are their strengths? And how do you think extroverts can tap into their introverted side and vice versa?
Introverts have so many strengths, you know, and just really the difference between introversion and extroversion is about energy. And that's what Carl Jung, who was the person who sort of first coined the term back in the 1800s, you know, talked about. It's like, how do you recharge your energy? And I oftentimes say to people, an introvert, to decide whether or not you're an introvert, must you have time to decompress after being with people? Now, extroverts get their energy off other people. That's what gets their motivation going and gets them moving. Some of the strengths of introverts include being calm, being wonderful listeners. They are observers. They kind of observe the landscape and then make conclusions about that. They focus on depth versus breadth, and that includes with projects they're working on, with relationships, where they're connecting with people. Then another trait that is oftentimes overlooked, but then people say, you know, you're right, is humility, being humble. And I think if you think about leaders who you've been exposed to, all of us have been exposed to, I think we oftentimes are surprised in a good way to remember that those most impactful leaders, and they don't necessarily have to be workplace leaders, but people that influenced us coming up in our lives, were people who had those traits.
Do you have any advice for extroverts trying to access that side of themselves?
So as far as extroverts or other people, whether you're an introvert or extrovert, getting the best from a team member who is an introvert, it's first of all, number one, having that conversation about what your preference is and what's their preference. Not to label each person, but to understand, first of all, how do you like to communicate? You know, do you like to communicate with me in writing? Is that your preference? Would you like to have me send you a heads up on what the meeting's going to be about or what I want to talk with you about, what the project's about? So preparation is really key, as we'll talk about. So really talking about what the preferences are is really important. This is aimed at particularly at extroverts, is the idea of a pause. Now, there's a colleague of mine, Patricia Fripp, who's a speech coach, and I love what she says about the pause. She says, a pause is not a moment of nothing. It is a chance to connect with somebody emotionally, intellectually. And I try to remember that when I'm talking with an introvert, is to give them the space. Now, I'm always not always great at it, and if you will ask extroverts, that's the hardest thing for them to do, because extroverts actually interrupt each other a lot. That's kind of how they talk. So they think an introvert is done speaking. So that's really important to pause and to recognize that. So I think, number one, sharing your own preferences, understanding what that other person's style is, and thirdly, just listening and pretend and really opening yourself up to what the introvert is saying. If you could do those things, introverts will so appreciate your willingness to try.
Your book centers on the 4 P's process.
Yes.
Can you talk a little bit about that?
The 4 P's is a model that I came up with the first book, and I've enhanced it in the second one. And it's really based on what I've learned from my research with successful leaders in all sorts of professions and organizations. And they were primarily introverted. They were pretty much all introverted. And I asked them questions about how they manage and how they amplify their strengths and how do they flex their style when they need to be successful in different leadership scenarios. You know, the typical scenarios that we find when you're having to manage a team or when you're having to give a speech or when you're having a network. Those are all things. I have a number of different scenarios that I looked at and I asked introverted leaders about. And what they said to me is that they take four basic steps. And the first step they take is to prepare. So that's the cornerstone of the 4 P's model. And I always call it the sweet spot for introverts, because introverts, you will find that you will ask them, you know, so did you read the agenda beforehand? Or did you review the speech and practice aloud? They say, absolutely, yes. They are, and that's their edge, by the way. So we can all do better at that. Preparation is the key for them. The second one is presence, and that's being in the moment. And that's remembering that you've done as much work as you can to prepare. You are not thinking about what the outcome is going to be. But you know how you're in the moment with somebody? Like, you know how you talk with somebody and they're just with you? Their feet are on the ground, their eyes are with you, you're showing it with body language, you're connected. And I remember the best leaders in my life have always been those people. A lot could be going on around them, but when I had their attention, they were with me and they were listening in a deep, reflective way. That's an example of being present. And in today's world, where we're being so taken off here and there and with social media and our devices, it's a gift that we need to give ourselves, but it's a gift to others. So presence is definitely a key. The third one is push. And that's about stepping out of our comfort zone. So it's pushing, you know, just enough so it's not too much, but enough that it is, you're feeling it some. So what we see introverted leaders do is they're constantly challenging themselves. They're saying, you know, I'm going to this conference and I'm going to make it my goal to talk to 5 new people. They set goals for themselves. And it's not real comfortable, but I'm actually going to plan what my purpose is in talking with these people at the trade show or, you know, meeting this person that could be good for our business growth. And they focus, so again, the preparation comes into that, but then they stretch themselves. So an example of push is, I was working with a client recently, Mary, who comes in the morning and she asked me to observe her, and she's basically heading as like a beeline to her office and looking like she's just focused on her job and not noticing anybody, not being present, right? So I said, you mentioned that people are not coming in to approach you. You're not, it seems like you're not very accessible. Why don't you try giving a smile to 1 or 2 people or making some eye contact? And she said, oh, do I have to? She was not very interested in that at all. But when we talked about the potential outcome of that, that it would help start building rapport and trust with a team that didn't really know her very well, then she was open to it and she tried it and it was a stretch. That's a good example of a push for her. And then she still does that and it did make a difference. Now, does she love it? No, but she's gotten better at it. And in fact, many introverted leaders have shared in the research that I did that most of their teams do not know that they're introverted because they have developed these skills. Not that they want to brag about that, but they say they have to convince them that they're really introverted because they have done those prepare, presence, and push. And then they've done the 4th thing, which is to practice. So Bill and I like to go to comedy shows. We find them not only entertaining, but we learn a lot from comedians. And one of the favorite comedians I like to watch on, not necessarily live, but online, is Jerry Seinfeld. And I wrote about him in the book, that something that really stuck with me. He said that, you know, you wonder, why does Jerry Seinfeld still need to go out there and do comedy shows? Other than he probably loves doing it. It's also, he said, to keep the broadband alive and keep it moving, because the minute that you stop practicing a skill, it does start to atrophy. And I think we've all experienced that. So what I found with introverted leaders is they look for opportunities to practice their skills. I had one person tell me recently after a speech that one of the things that he found that he is doing, he's getting better as being a team facilitator and meeting leader. But he said, you know what, Jennifer, last week I tried doing an icebreaker. He said it sounded kind of hokey with the engineers on my team. But he said, I pushed myself and we did it. And I practiced being better at engaging the group. And that's a tip where, you know, he's taking one step to continue to enhance his skills. And I know that person will keep learning. He reads, he'll pick up other ideas, and he'll keep refining that skill. So those 4 P's are a way for us to just organize our thinking about how we can all develop, not just introverted leaders, although we want to look at them as the models, and then keep enhancing and raising the bar on our own performance.
So can you talk about some of the challenges that introverts may face in the workplace? And strategies for them as well to overcome them.
One of the key challenges, in fact, 90% of introverts identify this in a survey, is people exhaustion. Now, when I say that to extroverts, they have no idea what that means. I kind of say in jest, you know, but truly, people can be very draining. for introverts. And so the main fix for that is to just be aware of what your limit is. That some introverts will tell me that they can go a whole day and be in a workplace that's got a lot of interruptions, and they can handle it as long as they can then take a break when they get home, you know, and not have to talk to people for a half an hour when they arrive at home. Everybody has their ways of dealing with it, but the key is to be aware of what your limit is. Another thing that comes up quite a bit is negative impressions. People will make assumptions. Because introverts don't oftentimes, in general, I'm generalizing, show a lot of facial affect. So many folks who are more expressive on their faces will project negative impressions on a face that doesn't reflect a lot. For instance, women will often tell me that they even have more challenges because they're supposed to be in organizations sort of friendly. The assumption is that they're very outgoing and friendly. And so when they're introverted and they're a woman, they oftentimes have that too. So the fix for that is not, again, to change who you are, but to just be aware, to imagine that there's a camera looking at you right now, like there is it with us as we're being filmed. And just to say, okay, what am I putting out there? And so it might raise the comfort level of people in the room if I were to just be aware of my body language, as I mentioned, make some eye contact, perhaps even smile. In fact, introverts will often tell me that's a coping mechanism, not to have the smile on all the time, but it kind of keeps, they say in jest, it keeps people away if I smile. They seem to, the extroverts kind of get simmered down a little bit. But again, a lot of this is so under the surface, we're not even aware. You know, it's body language and facial expressions are oftentimes very subconscious. A third area, besides the negative impressions and the people exhaustion, another big challenge for introverts, and this is a huge one, is underselling themselves. And I call it the undersell, and I get that from much of the feedback from introverts. And it really loops back to what I said earlier about introverts being overlooked. There's tremendous amount of bias if, let's say, an introvert is not speaking up in a meeting and they're thinking, they're not necessarily initiating a conversation, or they're not talking with their team or their boss or other people in the company about what they're achieving. People will assume that they haven't accomplished a lot. And what introverts will say to me is, well, I'm just doing my job. Why do I need to talk about it? Well, the reality is in today's world that we do need to share what we're up to. We can't expect that our managers or other team members are mind readers and can know about all the great things that we're doing. So it's a matter of balance. And how do we talk about ourselves in a way that feels comfortable? And many introverts told me that what they learned to do was to play to their sweet spot, to share on email, keep their team members and their boss updated, not having a vacuum of information to share what they've been up to kind of even practice in meetings when they're giving updates about how they're going to express their accomplishments, and being careful not to always say the team did this, but they've done it. And it's not easy, but it gets over time, like anything else, it does get easier. And then the cool way to frame it, I think, too, is that the organization and the team is missing out if they don't know about your value. And yes, we can ask people, we can try to solicit that information. But if we can each of us learn to do a little, as they say in the South, you know, don't brag on yourself. I would say brag on yourself a little bit as a flip of that. If we can start to talk about ourselves a little bit and what we've been up to and what we've accomplished, then it does get a little bit easier over time, I believe.
On the flip side, yeah. How can leadership and hiring managers avoid that natural unconscious bias towards introverts, particularly during hiring or during the promotion process?
Yes. Well, I think I would gear that to probably extroverts and introverts. If we're extroverted and we're not aware of what we're looking for when we're hiring people, we may project our own bias on people who are hiring. So in other words, if somebody's not answering a question, you know, in the moment after we ask it, and we don't pause and wait for them to explore their answer or follow up, then we might make judgments that are unfair or premature. So I think we have to be very mindful of how we set the environment up to make it comfortable. So that pause is really key. Also making sure that when I say the environment, the physical environment too. One of the things that introverts told me about, particularly in research for this last edition, was how stimuli affected their productivity. So if we have, let's say, an office setting that's very busy, or maybe it's an open office like many of them are now, we're doing an interview in the corner there, and people are going by, and there's, you know, all sorts of dinging going on from text messages, that could be very distracting to an introvert who needs, many times, prefers a more calm, quiet space. I think that's good behavior or practice for anybody we're interviewing. But if we're an extrovert and we're not tuned into that, that could be very off-putting. And again, we may reject that person because of that. We have to also be aware of our own personal preferences and not project that on the interviewee. Now, for introverts who are interviewing introverts, you want to. One of the tips that I give to them is to use the tool that many of us learn in communication classes, and that tool is paraphrasing. So one way to get people to talk more, if we all remember this, is when you say back in your own words what you've heard the answer to be from the candidate, then that allows them to explore even more and expound on their answer. And so you're not sort of throwing questions at them like you're on the witness stand. So what do you think of this? And let me ask you this follow-up question. So it becomes a lot more comfortable, and you'll get the introvert to open up more. And another thing that can happen when introverts are interviewing other introverts to be just aware of is something called confirmation bias, where they're answering and then it's confirming what you want in that person. So you have to be careful with your questioning that you're also eliciting different qualities, and think about that you want what you're really looking for in that position. It may be that personality is, you need an extrovert. You know, maybe there's somebody that has to do a lot of people interfacing and you need those qualities. So it's very important to use your skill of preparation to be, really be clear about what your purpose is when you're interviewing that person. So again, this all comes down to just awareness. I think once we have that understanding of introversion, extroversion, that's just another lens we can look through when we're hiring people.
So taking that a step further, it's like there are some steps that teams can implement to foster an introvert-friendly environment. Mm-hmm. So do you have any examples of those?
Oh, yes, absolutely. I've seen teams do some wonderful things in this day and age. And workspace is an important element of all of this. It's like, how are we using the workspace to have the idea of having people meet in small groups? Introverts tend to like really working one-on-one in small groups. So if you go into a lot of our offices today, you'll see that there are different options. You know, we have pods, we have one-on-one places, little cubbies to meet at. We have long tables. And so they're using the workspace to really encourage people to really play to their best at different times of the day. So you're not isolated, but you're also not having to be with talking to people all the time. I heard one example of a company, a Hallmark, who actually had they set up long tables like we sometimes see in the local coffee shop where people are sitting together. But if you're there, the rule is that you can speak to other people. It's okay. There are other spaces where it's like the old study hall, you don't talk. You know, it's quiet. So I think using that open office space is important. I think also looking at the remote option for work environments. You know, we have to look at where that works for teams and where it doesn't. A lot of people prefer that who are introverted, but many will tell you they like a balance. They like also to go into the office. So that's key. Another tool, it comes up a lot in meetings. I probably get the most questions from readers and people who attend my programs about meetings, and I think a lot of consultants will tell you that, where we're very extrovert focused there. It's like, what's the answer to this question? We need to solve this dilemma. You know, there's that fast pace, and we don't think about slowing it down, number one, taking breaks. We need to make sure that we're giving people a chance to stretch, to get their bodies moving, but also not necessarily having to solve all these problems in that one meeting. Let's give the introverts a chance to, if we can, take a day or two to reflect and come back. And by the way, we get better output from everybody, not just the introverts. One leader told me, everybody on the team is giving me better answers because I'm giving them space to think it through. Now, that's not always possible. Sometimes we have to come up with those answers right away. So one technique that's been very successful is something called brain writing, where people, instead of brainstorming the typical way, which we know, what happens there is who gets their answers on the flip chart, right, or on the whiteboard. It's the people that talk, that think on their feet, which are extroverts, which nothing wrong with that. But again, we're missing 50% of the answers if we're doing that. So have people write down their responses. Ask the question, write it down. Some groups will circulate the paper and then have people add to it. We also have technical tools that now can do that. A lot of that happens also in remote meetings when we have WebExes and different kinds of conferences like that, where you can give introverts a chance to communicate and give input in the chats. And by the way, I do a lot of online classes, and the most vibrant chats that we have with introverts, I teach mostly introverts, are on the group chat, not on the phone.
Wow.
So writing is a real strength and a comfort zone for introverted leaders.
What advice would you give for those introverts that find themselves surrounded by extroverts?
Take a breath. Take a breath and honor that quiet time. I think that's the key with all of this. That's where introverts get their reserve. In fact, we all need to go back to that place of silence and serenity and breathing. So breathing, I talk about that, it's underrated. We all breathe, but do we really breathe? Because when we breathe and pay attention to our breath, that anxiety goes away, the thoughts are churning, they go away, they can simmer down, and introverts find that then they can calm down. And it's not necessarily, I was interested in doing, when I did research for Quiet Influence, one of my books, I really tried to look at what were the strengths introverts amplified to be effective influencers. And one of the things that I was kind of surprised at was that many of them did it when they were working out, when they were taking a walk. It wasn't like taking quiet time meant that you had to isolate. But it's taking those moments where it was absolutely critical. And I think that would be the one piece of advice I would say is like reflection. Because when you don't have that time, that's when the stress really can accumulate. Maybe not the first day, maybe not the second day, but by the end of the week, you're going to go home and you might be yelling at the dog or your kids and have a short fuse. And that can really get in the way. So I think really honoring your need to be quiet and to protect those quiet times. Because I think with organizations, one of the things we do is get a lot of pressure and we feel that we have to say yes to everything. So protecting our times, let's say, in it's okay to block out some time on the calendar and not say yes to every meeting. And so asking yourself those questions, is my life out of whack right now because I am not honoring my introversion? And that's the biggest aha I get from introverts too. It's like when they realize that, it's really transformative in how they then go forward with their lives.
What do you think the future holds for introverted leaders and their organizations?
I think the future looks really bright for introverted leaders. I think the world is open to understanding more about what introverts bring to the table. And I think we have never needed the strengths of introverts as much as we do now. So I'm very optimistic and can't wait to see what introverted leaders do next.
Jennifer, thanks so much for sharing your insight with us today. I invite you to take a look by adding this important book to your Skillsoft playlist.